This is kind of a Christmas song, really, if you're thinking about your loved ones.
A song written by Brian, it's called the Prophet Song. Listen to the mad, 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 to the madman.
But then they went to Boston. There's nothing like summer in the city. There's trouble in the air, you can smell it. I'll let them tell it.
Here I stand.
Here I stand.
Look around, 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 around.
We were very lucky in that we hooked up with Mott the Hoople, and we were their warm-up act.
Now I'm here.
And we went all around the UK with them, and it worked out just perfect.
Now I'm there.
Now I'm there.
And then the guys from Mott said, would you like to do the same thing in America?
I'm just...
After a few gigs, I started to feel weird and something was happening. I didn't know if it was my head or my body or whatever, you know, but I started to feel odd. And then I woke up one morning in Boston, which was going to be the climax of the tour. I woke up and looked at myself and I was yellow. And the doctor came around and said, you've got hepatitis, you have to go home.
I still was amazed we managed to shepherd him through the immigration queue at JFK in New York. Poor fella could hardly stand.
I was sort of taken on the plane, shoulder to shoulder.
We were devastated the tour had been cut short, you know, because it was our first trip to America. But we just sort of ploughed on in the studio without him.
It was a bit of a long haul back to health. I was just sort of getting over all this stuff, and I remember seeing Freddie batting out all these things, you know, and thinking, God, I have not got my shit together, you know, and really starting to worry about it.
Then they made Killer Queen.
She keeps them always shown, though. A pretty cabinet, let them eat cake, she says, just like Marie Antoinette.
Queen 1, Queen 2 were full-on rock albums, and I suppose it was only a question of time before they put some really clever melody into it, and Sheer Heart Attack was that breakout album, and a track like Killer Queen with Mercury's vocals had probably never been better.
She's a killer queen, gunpowder, gelatine, dynamite with a laser beam.
I do remember having a slight reservation about Killer Queen, and I remember thinking, are we kind of selling ourselves as something which has become very, very light? But every slice through that record is a perfect vision. There's lots of little things which visit once only, like the little bell of the cymbal.
Same address, in conversation, she spoke just like a baroness. Middleman, trying to hold down to gauge your mind.
Killer Queen always felt a bit special. It was very sophisticated, and it was very Freddie.
As the albums have progressed, I mean, our sort of songwriting has progressed, and we sort of ventured into sort of different areas. I like writing different songs, you know. We don't like to sort of repeat the same formula.
It had a sort of slightly Noel Coward, you know, that kind of element in it.
When you took the lyrics apart, you thought, how incredible is that? Because they were so clever.
Drop of a hat, she's as willing as, playful as a pussycat. Momentarily out of action, temporarily out of class. You absolutely try.
Try.
doing lots of major tours in Japan and America. We were headlining by now and doing very well and selling loads and loads of records and not seeing any money.
What we decided to do was go with a production company rather than with a record company. And the deal was that we made the album for the production company, they sell it to a record company. In retrospect, it's probably the worst thing we ever did.
The deal that they were on just meant that they weren't going to make any money out of what they did. And the way it came to a head was with the song Death on Two Legs.
You suck my blood like a leech. You break the law and you breach. Screw my brain till it hurts.
I would go to do an interview and I would buy a couple of bottles of wine, you know, on my expenses because they just didn't have any money.
We didn't expect instant riches or anything. We didn't get them either.
Roger is breaking sticks because he's hitting the drums pretty hard and the management's going, we don't want you breaking any more sticks, you know, we can't afford to do that. So we had no money.
At the opera. The album is, without doubt, Queen at their absolute finest as musicians, composers and producers, harnessing an incredible array of musical styles. Whether you're into rock, pop, opera, heavy metal, folk, music hall or trad jazz, A Night at the Opera has it all. In fact, it was created when the band were on the brink of financial ruin and was, at the time, the UK's most expensive album ever produced, brings into sharp focus what a huge risk they were taking.
I remember when we went into the studio to make A Night at the Opera, it felt like make or break.
We were not only poor, but we were in debt. All the sound and lighting companies and the people that we worked with hadn't been paid. So we were at a really crucial point. We might have had to break up if that album hadn't done well. It was an expensive album. Enormous complexity on there. Even looking at it now, I wonder how we did some of that stuff.
The leap of faith paid off. And it completely changed the landscape for Queen, thanks to some hit singles including You're My Best Friend,
Ooh, You're Making Me Live,
by bassist John Deacon, and this legendary creation.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
But more of that later. A Night at the Opera topped the charts across the globe, going on to sell over 6 million copies, giving it platinum status in many countries, including multi-platinum in the US. It received universal acclaim and would continue to collect accolades year after year. And in 2018, it was deservedly inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame.
See, bring it back, bring it back. Don't take it away.
Without doubt, a milestone in the Queen story. We could talk for hours about this remarkable achievement, but instead, let's leave the music to speak for itself. Bohemian Rhapsody. Lauded as one of the best songs ever written, the list of accolades for this extraordinary composition is endless. Delivering the band their first number one hit single, it went on to become the only song to sell over a million copies on two occasions in the UK, is the most streamed song of the 20th century, and in March 2021 reached the extremely rare RIAA Diamond status in the US. Making Queen the first British band ever to earn such an award.
Mama, please kill the man. Put a gun against his head. Pull my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun. But now I've got to throw it.
So while the weeks of painstaking work in the studio to create this masterpiece have clearly paid off, no one could have predicted that just 4 hours spent by the band at Elstree Studios on the 10th of November could change the course of music history forever.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the bandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
We made a video for Bohemian Rhapsody simply because we were on tour and we weren't able to go on Top of the Pops.
To be honest, we weren't too keen on going on Top of the Pops and standing on those little podiums and kind of miming Bohemian Rhapsody. It would have been really crap.
We used an outside broadcast sports unit to use their, bring in their cameras into Elstree where we were rehearsing. And we could go on the road and that could be on Top of the Pops. And we realised, wow, you don't even have to be here to promote your record now. You know, you just make one of these little video films and that's got to be the way in future, you know. And we were the first to do that.
Let him go!
We will not let you go!
I think it's the first video that actually took any kind of effect into actually making sales, you know. A lot of videos were probably made before, but, I mean, they didn't sell records. I think it's the first one that actually sort of, there was this chemistry that actually linked visuals with the music, and it worked.
Easy come, easy go.
Directed by Bruce Gowers and costing just £4,500, this promo for Bohemian Rhapsody is widely regarded to have given birth to the practice of creating music videos. As a result, this dramatic imagery has become as iconic and recognisable as the song itself. It's no surprise then that it was the first pre-1990s music video to pass the 1 billion views milestone on YouTube. Without doubt, one of the most defining moments in Queen's history. There really is nothing else quite like Bohemian Rhapsody.
I say Queen ranks, in rock and roll sense, is one of the greatest bands of all time. And I think that was cemented at Hyde Park.
This is a song slightly more in the vicious vein, written by Freddie in one of his more passionate moments, of which he has many. This is Flick of the Wrist. Thank you.
Brain with what I'm saying, that's you lying, eating rubber. Prostitute, you say.
It's large. Definitely one of their biggest shows. And other than that, I think.
Baby, you've been.
That's all I can really say, is that I'm a legend.
If I can be honest, once Queen made the album Jazz, they just started touring like absolutely crazy. They made a live album out of all of the bits of film. Well, they made a live album out of all of the soundboards they could use on the 1979 European leg of the Jazz Tour. Typical English weather, but anyway. Is a montage of a bunch of different bits of Queen's Jazz Tour.
This is called Bohemian Rhapsody.
Oh,
it's Radio Gaga.
Radio!
Queen's 1984 album The Works was a perfect example of how the songwriting responsibilities within the band had evolved over the first 13 years.
In the early days, it was Brian and Freddie who really used to write most of the material, but in over the last sort of, you know, 5 years, and Roger and I have, you know, started to contribute more.
I think the time has come where we actually, in songwriting, we actually completely even. Roger will come up with something like Radio Gaga, and it's perfect.
A Sunday afternoon, my son Felix came in, he was very young, and he just sort of went, ah, radio, caca, because he's half French. And it's quite nice, you know. I sort of put the backing track together and then sort of presented it to Freddie, who really loved it.
Hardly need to use our ears, our music changes.
The song raced up the British charts and became a worldwide hit, unsurprisingly attracting a huge amount of radio play. However, ironically, given the song's subject matter, it was the video, directed once again by the brilliant David Mallet, that caught the imagination of the MTV generation.
We had a killer video, which we put a lot of work into.
You had the time, you had the power, you yet to...
And the whole thing just felt good, and it felt of its time, it felt a bit different. Felt modern, and it was very fresh.
All we hear is Radio Gaga. Radio.
Inevitably, some members of the British press wanted a reason to dismiss it, and accused Queen of incorporating fascist imagery, a notion that Roger found more amusing than annoying.
That was so absurd. I mean, it was actually meant to be about the film, you know, it was meant to sort of mirror the film and this, the oppressed workers and etc. And the Nazi thing is laughable, really. People will always find an agenda if they need one. And it's a piece of entertainment, you know, simple as that.
If the success of the video and single wasn't enough, Radio Gaga had an even bigger impact when it came to the Queen live shows.
One of Mallet's great contributions, of course, is when the chorus comes, you get a hand clap. It was repeated electronically on the record, and so it sounds like a double hand clap, and Mallet kind of seized upon it and made it a double hand clap done by the audience, and it became something so... I think it became one of the first great proofs of the power of television. The first time we played this to a non-Queen audience at Live Aid, everybody knew what to do at that point, which is astonishing, really, so it has to be just the power of the video.
Waiting for life to go by. dinner. What must it become of what we've done to the world that we created?
We are the champions. We are the champions.
People, you've been a tremendous, you've been a really special audience. Thank you very much. Good night, sweet dreams. We love you.